Huntsville, Alabama, at the Marshall Space Flight. And he also has over 81 publications, at least according to his Orchid ID, and over $1 million in grant funding. So he's certainly a wise person to listen to about how to define your research question. And without further ado.
Thank you, thank you. Just correcting a couple of numbers here. $25 million. Not different from
I said
what?
Over $1 million.
Oh, over $1 million. I'm Hamid Wassoul, and it's my pleasure to give this presentation. This presentation was produced for the faculty, and then some of my colleagues from the library attended, and they decided that this might be good for graduate students as well, anybody who writes a proposal. And the idea of these 9 questions, which they call it Altmaier, and we'll get to know Altmaier in a minute, the Altmaier Catechism. Catechism is the word for come from the Catholic faith, right? The rules and regulations of that one. So here,
Huntsville, Alabama, at the Marshall Space Flight. And he also has over 81 publications, at least according to his Orchid ID, and over $1 million in grant funding. So he's certainly a wise person to listen to about how to define your research question. And without further ado.
Thank you, thank you. Just correcting a couple of numbers here. $25 million. Not different from
I said
what?
Over $1 million.
Oh, over $1 million. I'm Hamid Wassoul, and it's my pleasure to give this presentation. This presentation was produced for the faculty, and then some of my colleagues from the library attended, and they decided that this might be good for graduate students as well, anybody who writes a proposal. And the idea of these 9 questions, which they call it Altmaier, and we'll get to know Altmaier in a minute, the Altmaier Catechism. Catechism is the word for come from the Catholic faith, right? The rules and regulations of that one. So here, these questions, before even we get to the next level of the technical aspects of the proposal. No matter how good the proposal is, if there is no answer to these questions that we will talk about it, then there's some problem with this proposal. So he had a PhD in solid state material, inventor of the liquid crystal display. So any of you digital, he's the one. Member of the National Academy of Engineering, National Medal of Science, and then he's just going White House Fellow, Assistant to the Secretary of Defense, Director of the DARPA, Department of Defense Vice President, and the Chief Technical Officer of Texas Instruments. That's what I met him for the first time. I used to work for Texas Instruments briefly while I was a graduate student. And of course, I wasn't top engineers over there, I was a packing engineer. Making sure that when you buy your calculator, there are also the guidelines or everything is associated with it, it is in the box. So the packing engineers, that's how it's like. So it's a, and then the president and CEO of the Belcourt Chairman, he's a magnificent fellow. He helped the agency come up with these questions to help agency officials think through and evaluate proposals. In my own experience, over the years, as a PI or as a reviewer for NASA, and especially the Department of Defense, it's equally this question, answer to this question is equally important and for any technical proposal, including the proposal that you write for the PhD. They are extremely useful, both to yourself and to build up your proposal and communicating to the reviewer what you hope to achieve. While there have been many variety of the questions of these Altmaier questions, there are, if you search, you Google it, Altmaier question, there is a variety of them available. I still prefer the original 9 questions. And as you see, each question is critical in a successful chain of events. And as we come back to that on question 1, 7, and 8, answer to the question 1, 7, and 8 is for program officer. Answer to the question 4, 6, and 9 for expert reviewers. That's your advice. Answer to the question 2, 3, 5 is for the financial manager.
Yeah.
Those who, and there is always one person over there. Doesn't care about the science, but you want to know that how much it costs and how long would it take you to do the review. So let's go to the question. What are you trying to do? Articulate your objective using absolutely no jargon. This is the question number 1. What are you trying? That is where you avoid acronym, you avoid jargons in your field with a simple, simple language. You're saying that, what are you trying to do? And then trying to, and we'll come back to all of these individually. How is done today, and what are the limits of the current practice? So anytime you're writing a proposal, you're putting this question in front of you, go back to the example of the satellite, and now, with that idea, then you answer the question, each one of them. And then I'll tell you what to do with the answers. So third, what is the new in your approach and why do you think it will be successful? Fourth, a very important one, who cares? Why should we give your taxpayers money to do that? Fifth, if you succeed, what differences will it make? Economical, geopolitical, you name it, whatever it is. Does the military benefit from this? Does the medical community benefit from this? And what are the risks and what are the payoff of that? And this is very important. How do you say that you may fail? You don't say it. I will tell you how to say it. That there is a risk involved when I'm doing this. And then how much will it cost? And how long will it take? And then what are the midterm and the final exam to check for success? Let's go to each, let's examine each question one by one. So I have my cheat notes here. We'll get to let's go. Now two more suggestions that I added on the top of these is why you, and here you need to add a section on qualification of the key personnel. You assume that the reviewer is going to read the bio sketch and also facility appendix that you have at the end. No. Reviewer, most of the time, will read. Every reviewer read the body of the proposal, but not necessarily the appendices. Unless you can impress them, then they may look at it better. So here, you need to say that why you should do this one. What is your qualification? And then, why now? Talk about opportunity cost. What happened if you don't do this now, and then the agency decided to delay that decision for another year to give you money, or in the future? So those are the things which I'll come back to that one later. Let's go to the questions itself. Do I want to say anything more about this? Let me just look at why. I said, put the section in the project description, title of qualification of the key personnel, why you and your team are unique in position. We already said that one. And that's what it is. Okay, now let's go to the question. What are you trying to do? State the goal of the project using absolutely no jargon. And here is where I have a lot of notes that I've built over the years. One, federal funding agency want to support hypothesis-driven research. Instead of saying, we will study this process, and most of us will do that. When we write something, we say that, I will study the deorbiting of the spacecraft. Instead of saying, we will study these, or we will measure X, that the state overall goal of your project in terms of the questions to be answered or the hypothesis to be tested. So the question in that example that I gave you, the question would be, what will happen to the orbit of the satellite as you have a solar flare hitting Earth upper atmosphere? And what is the cost? This is where you bring the attention of the program officer to your proposal. Make a distinction between the goal, which is hypothesis to be tested, and objective, which is the intermediate steps. Intermediate steps, I need to measure this, I need to get this data. Who cares about that one at that point? The state, the major goal, instead of going directly to what you're going to measure. What you want to do is go, and how you're going to go about accomplishing it, that is your objective. I've emphasized before, no jargon. No jargon rule is a good one, and you need to follow. Not everyone who reads your proposal can decide what is fake. Maybe an expert in your narrow field. If you have to use jargon, explain your term at least the first time. And never ever use undefined acronym. If you say that I'm going to study the effect of the solar activity CME on orbit of satellite, how many of you, when was the last time you heard the term CME? Most of us heard it in terms of continuing medical education. That's what the doctors, nurses, and everybody. But it is a stat for coronal mass ejection. If you say that the effect of the CME on IMF, that's what I'm going to study, then they think that you are somebody, non-expert, may think that you are studying continuing medical education on International Monetary Fund, which is completely different than coronal mass ejection, this huge island of the plasma moving at 1,000,000 kilometers per hour. These are the size of 50 times the size of Earth, this big island of the plasma, upper part of the sun, exploding, coming out of the atmosphere and moving toward Earth. That's what we call CME. That thing is going to hit Earth, and the magnetic field of Earth is starting to ring. The IMF is interplanetary magnetic field in that sense. So don't assume the acronym is clear for everyone, especially financial guy who will read your proposal. Now, let's go to the next. How is done today, and what are the limits of the current practice? Explicitly address this question in your background and introduction. Cite freely. Make sure that even when you haven't read the paper, I should say this one. Make sure that the old-timer's name is recognized. Rasul did this one in 1973, because Rasul might be reading your proposal, and he may get offended if you are not saying his name. You could say that another reference in 1985 and say that within references within, then we will be happy. But if you ignore the work of the people who did pioneer this work before, then you're probably turning off a few lights. So explicitly address this question, how is done today and what are the limits of current practice? This thing is done today by looking at the GPS signal variation. Because, like going back to my example, GPS variation. It is done today using the density variation measured by this and this and that, and the orbital. Now, you could say that what are the limitations of that? That's where the third question comes, which is talking about what is new in your approach and why do you think it will be successful? Now, you acknowledge the work done before. Now you're going back to say that the work which was done before is taking two-dimensional analysis of density. Now I am taking the three-dimensional, which is going to provide us with this additional information about the latitudinal or longitudinal change in orbit of the satellite. So not just the disk, but also if the satellite not is going in one direction, Z, but also in XY. Doesn't change it as it comes to this way or that way. So you are spending $180 million, you're putting a communication satellite above the United States, you try to get the HEO signal with that part, and because of one of these storms, the satellite drifts and then go above Mexico or Argentina, and then it's good for them, not good for us. Now I have to sit down in the bargaining table and then selling the $180 million satellite, $25 million, get some of my money back, or turn off the satellite. So the even if it stays in the same orbit, it may just drift in the latitude or the longitude. So, the next person will get a good bargain if it's moved over there. Now, the next one is who cares? Is problem important to anybody besides your research group? I am interested in changing the atmosphere density. But is this problem important to any other? Tell the program officer and reviewer who benefits from this. Not only the media company, the HBO signals, or whatever it is, but the military, where they have a lot of birds over there, and then all these birds has to stay focused in one location. Probably most of them are now on top of North Korea. So a solar storm may just shift some of them to some other place that you don't want. So you want to know that where these birds are moving, who will benefit from it. That is where your speculation is. So remember, you're writing your proposal for PhD, the same question can be applied. And I will share that one in a moment with you. So let's get to number five. If you succeed, what difference will it make? What will your successful project mean for your research, for the infrastructure of your institution, for future capability of your professional community, for your discipline, for related discipline? In my case, I'm a space scientist, so I want to know that the investment of the satellite, but related scientists, every field that using the satellite communication, every time you use the car, not this car, buying the gas, so the gas stations are also interested in orbits of and deorbits of the spacecraft. For the society, for the funding agency, so if you are successful, what difference would it make? Will it create new knowledge? And there is a question, right?
Yeah.
Introduce yourself.
My name is Boaz Fessy. I'm a master's student.
Wonderful. All right.
So my question is, what's the difference between answering this question and the question number three?
Let's go back to the number three. What new in your approach? This
yeah.
is a what?
Yeah, why do you, no. The question is like, why do you do your research? That question. I don't remember.
What are you trying to do? State the goal. How is the not? Okay. What are you trying to do?
Which one?
Yes.
20.
Yes.
Three. Four.
That's what
I think. Three and four.
Yes. Three and four. What is in you in Europe? This is very technical things that you're trying to say. You say that I'm trying to do a two-dimensional approach. I'm going to solve the continuity equation of the plasma. I'm going to do these things. That is the way your technical goal is going to get you. This, you are answering different audience. So that means nine questions. Each question, answer to each question is designed for a different audience. This is you answering to experts who evaluate. Now going with number four. Who cares? This is now for general manager, the money guy. The guy who has to sell your project to a senator. Goes to the state of Florida and talk to Senator Nelson and say that I am supporting $10 million to this fellow in university such and such in Florida to do this, this stuff. You see how good I am in Florida? So next time we'll be good to Ohio. And so that's where the whole agency is. This is the financial. And then you go to this one. If you are successful, what differences will make? That's now you're talking again to the big general office. That's the senator. Now Nelson himself is interested in that.
So here, do we go in details or the big picture?
This is big picture. This is big picture. So you're defining what are the questions. And then it's perfectly fine when you write, before you write, you have your idea. You're trying to answer these questions. Write them as concise as possible. Bullet is good. NASA loves bullets. So you write bullets, then you put in the use the index card. So questions, and here you write. Okay. Now you put in all of these questions together. Then you're gonna go read the announcements of opportunity, the RFP which came for that proposal. Any RFP which is coming out, it says that you have to have specifically this section. So go to your typewriter, word processor, and then write the title of those sections. Then you look at your questions and the answer. Some of them immediately fit into those. So you put them there, but you still have answer to the few questions. Then you decide. As you're feeling more material, putting more beef into this thing, you decide that should I create a new section? Never miss answer to those questions. If there is nothing in an RF for that one, create a section for that. They appreciate that. So you put in the answer to those questions in that one. Make it easy for reviewers to find answer to those questions. Don't not necessarily writing the questions and then giving the answer. Say that. The importance of this for the society is the following, and then you just put it there. I had a colleague who always used an italic for that, but I hate it. But some people use that italic for the what they call bold fonts and all of that thing. You just said, hey, idiot, look at this. I don't like it. As a reviewer, I don't like it. I like it. So, when you're successful, what difference will it make? Will it create new knowledge? We talked about all of related disciplines, funding agency, what good for the funding agency, for the society, but does it create new knowledge? Train the next generation of the scientists and engineers, and that is very important for the faculty. We're saying that these are the creating three PhDs, two masters, or something like this there, and contribute to the nation research infrastructure and the technical capability. Solve an important scientific, technical, social, or social technical problem. Contribute to the economic development. All of those things, it goes to number five. Now, here comes the tricky one. Next question. What are the risks and what are the payoffs? Candidly discuss risk. And most of us, we try to avoid that. We never say that what happened to our project failed. Candidly discuss risk, but use positive language. Don't ever say a proposal is risky. If you say that, funding agency employees tend to be risk hostile. If you say they're risky, that's the end of it, especially if you come from a small university. Now, if somebody comes from MIT and say that this project is risky, they say that we could trust them. But if I'm at Waxahachie Community College, Texas, and I'm writing a proposal, I have a brilliant idea, I'm not going to say that this is a risk. You discuss the risk, but be very positive. I did a lot of workshop on this for years when I was younger. And then when I go through these things, we had presented the question and asked the audience to come back next time with an idea, answering to this question, and then we write the proposal together in 3 hours, effort. Then I give the proposal from the person one, give it to the next, and the next, and then we have a question and say, let's crystallize this. That's the one way to do that. Having a workshop on proposal writing. But you could do these things yourself. You could, very nice, because the guideline is very, very simple. And then with the right amount of the fee, you may find somebody to evaluate. Not me. That is, so, again, be very careful. It's speculative or promising or potential high payoff is okay. Risky is the kiss of the death. It's perfectly fine. That's why I'm saying that being positive. We speculate about that. You say that the success of this protocol may provide additional information for such and such. Promising for potential high payoff is perfectly fine, but don't say that the risk. So next question. And you know that the answer to this question is for who? Finance guy. Everybody is interested, but the finance guy is going to skip the whole thing and find how much it costs. That is the one that. So, the program announcement. This is one of the boundary conditions of any proposal. There are two boundary conditions we'll talk about. Question number 7 and question number 8. 7 is how much it costs, 8 is how long does it take you to do this. If you just say that for the next 10 years, I'm not going to forget it. That's, so, the program announcement, the RFP is coming, often is specified the maximum amount that can be requested. They say that we have a $5 million and then we hope to provide 20 award, then that will give you an estimate of what is the maximum that they are looking for. Typically, if you exceed that limit, your proposal will be non-responsive. Not bad, but non-responsive. You did not pay attention to the detail. So, and will be returned without the review. Program officers, the reviewers, they want to reduce the number of the proposals that they get. So they're looking for violations. And the violation is going to go down here and say that send it back to the person. You won't get even reviewed to the content to improve the content of the proposal. You just say non-responsive and the proposal is coming back. Now, if what happened if the program announcement, the RFP, does not specify the budget limit, then it will often indicate how much money has been allocated for the program, total, and how many awards the agency expects. Again, you can use that information to see that what is the typical maximum budget. The next question is going to tell us, this was how much it cost. The next one, how long would it take? That's the second part. How long will it take? Read the program announcement carefully and be sure your proposal fits the prescribed duration. They will tell you that this proposal, the duration of the proposal is for this program for the next 5 years. You never should go above the next 5 years. Indeed, my rule of thumb is to go 50% of that. So if it's a 6 years, I go 3 years. And that is very, because that will, I use it as a phase one study, and I say that upon the success of the phase one, then the proposers will request for the phase two with this additional stuff. And then I will have a section for that.
So, yeah. So in this case, you have to limit the scope of the whole research?
Yes. Limit the scope, which means that you're limiting the amount of the money that you're asking. You don't want to go above the maximum. And also, you are saying that I have a final exam, or you can call it midterm exams for that. Instead of giving you the 6 years program, which at the end I have to write a report to say that how I succeeded, I'm gonna make it a phase one or phase two. Give me the money for the phase one, I will give you the result, and if you are happy, we are happy, married in heaven, then I'll give you the second phase.
So on like a, it's not the same program, it's like a, how to say, another program of another session of the program, or?
No, it is the same program. It's the same program. It's like, for me, it would be planetary atmosphere, the sciences, and then I look at the program. These days I'm a little bit bold, I'm writing big proposal. But when you start, you don't want to start with a $10 million. And so you have to show some success from the smaller amount of the money with a smaller duration before you jump into asking for a big one. Right now, I'm not writing any proposal less than $1 million.
Yeah.
But it took me 25 years, 30 years to get to. That's, and you already have credential, you already have the people know you, and they know that this guy can deliver. So they, even if you are not fully certain that you will be successful, they know you based on the success that you had in your past.
And if you ask for half what is proposed,
yeah,
you diminish the risk and you upload the increase the probability of success.
That's right.
You
That's right. Because let's say that in that example that I gave you for the satellite, if I just put the latitudinal drift of the satellite, not only in a one-dimensional model, which is just the altitude changing itself. If I put the latitudinal drift, that is becoming from 1D problem, one dimension, to 3D. That's a very tough problem to handle. So you could say that the focus of this is to looking at the altitudinal variations of the satellite as a result of the CMEs, coronal mass ejections. And this is your focus. It says, I will examine also possibility of the latitudinal variation as a potential follow-up study. So you're telling them that this is your mind, but that's not the focus. And you never say that one at the beginning, when you say that, what are you trying to do? Trying to do, I'm looking at the altitudinal variation. Don't put the latitudinal variation. Because that, the scope becomes much, much more difficult. Because now you have to not only worry about the magnetic field, but also the twist of the magnetic field and the turbulence of the magnetic field, which is extremely difficult. All right, let's go to the next one. And this is the last one. What are the midterm and the final exam? Check for success. Everybody wants to know that, do you have the skin? Do you have a plan that evaluates your success, your progress, the project that you do, how it's proceeding, so that you know when to make mid-course correction? So there's a milestone available. I'm going to work on the ACE spacecraft, which is the data is available, and then it's easily this. Then I will apply my method to this spacecraft first year. Upon the success of the result, then I will apply it to these other five spacecraft. That's the milestones that you identify. You do that one for your PhD proposal also. You just put the big pictures and then you put the milestones. First year, six months, 1 year, so on. So the milestones become very important. What metrics will you use to evaluate progress? These are your exams. How do you give yourself A, B, C? You are very, very successful. it's successful. What metrics are you going to use? In these examples that I provided, the metrics would be the variational process of the latitude. So if I say that the altitude dropped from 400 kilometers to 200 kilometers, then what is the variation? What is the variance of that? Because the variance is plus minus 50 kilometers or plus minus 1 kilometer. That is how I'm, the metrics that I use for calculating and reporting my result. How will you analyze and evaluate your data? How we will know when you are done? And most people, they forget about this important thing. You say, I'm going to study this, I'm going to study this, I'm going to study this until when? Was the pigs flying or something like that? Something like this. So you have to have an idea of when this problem you considering this is successful and you don't. Sometimes you get the result of the proposal in 2 years and you still have 1 year left. You get it early. It happened to me many times. And I said, yes, now I'm going to go back to the program officer and say that I can start the next, you don't give up the money, you just say that the result is very successful, you have publications, you have talks, you have a seminar, and say that I'm going to continue and adding this component to the problem. And they always welcome. So when you know that you are done with the proposed problem. So these are the questions that, the 9 questions. So let's go back to here. Let's go here. We talked about this. Why you? You have your expertise. I'm a plasma physicist. I understand the astrodynamics of the spacecraft. I am from a technical university where there are a group of the scientists and technical staff to help me and brag about the university. You are not from the Maxahatchee. You are from Florida Tech. Nothing against Maxahatchee. But they have the problem with some other aspects, not this step. And then why not? It says that the next solar maximum is coming. The energy input to the atmosphere, it will be as big as this one is predicted by, and then you give the reference. So there will be a more loss of the satellite. We need to understand the deorbiting of the spacecraft. Now, if you understand the book, how are you going to prevent it? Now, what is an understanding? Another one is putting more thrusters in the spacecraft so you can adjust the orbit. But the thrusters, they have a limited battery. How can you charge the spacecraft when the battery is up? The latest technique is you have a mother satellite shooting a high energy laser on the back of that thruster and then recharge it. That is now, there's millions of dollars in that technology. When you have a mother satellite, high energy laser, the thrusters are all have the like a solar cell, and you're shooting on the back, you make sure they're not shooting the satellite itself, and then the thruster is charged. So that's you can expand the life expectancy of the satellite. So let's go to the next one. So that's great. Now let's see how I can use the question and get started on the writing to compelling proposal. I think I already talked about this one, but let's see how. All right. I'm going to go to this. Think about how each question relates to the project you have in mind. Write down the question and then start. Write down the answer to the question in full sentences, be explicit and specific. Use bullets. You can write the text around. If you are not comfortable with English, use any language that you are comfortable with. That's perfectly fine. Somebody will fix your English. You are not Shakespeare. You are a scientist. You write it down. Get the help of somebody to do it technical or the language correction for you. Write down the main answer to each of the questions. Use Answers 7 and 8. How much it costs? How long it takes? As the boundary condition for the promises that you give. These are the boundary conditions on your proposal, cost and time. Now, the blue part is you going back and looking at announcements, research announcements, that program announcement, and make an outline with a mandatory section in order they are presented in the RFP. They want you to talk about this. Just write it down. Then, just like a jigsaw puzzle, you put the answer of each question to the sections that is required. And you have a leftover. And for now, the rest of your answer to the question in a separate section, put a separate section for that one, you use in a mandatory section later, somehow you match it, or you present it in a new section. Additional information. Additional week, or I don't know, whatever it is, constraints on these proposals. Make sure the answers are. Don't eliminate it just because the RFP doesn't ask you. So, you got a working outline, the skeleton is done, now it's adding detail. Skeleton is done, now it's just adding. So, you go back to those questions, you say that, like, I said here, the satellite is deorbiting. Maybe I should get some of the answer and make sure that the Rasul reference is there. So now you go read the Rasul's papers and then get the quotations, whatever it is. Just put it there, just in case. And by attending the conferences, and that's why it's important for faculty to attend conferences. We are not going there to listen to the 10 minutes presentation. We're going there to meet our reviewers. There are 2,000 probably planetary scientists working in my field. I know most of them. I go to the conferences to tell them that first, I'm still alive. And second, I'm still active. I'm going to read your proposal, and you better read my proposal well, too. So that's how, that's why you need to go to the conference, even if you don't. Now, of course, for that one, you need the money. If you are a student, ask your advisor. Ask to support you partially. There are conferences like the Astrophysical Conference, American Geophysical Union, which is a conference, the Physical Society. They always have some support for graduate students. They always. But they ask you, instead of everybody else come at 8 o'clock, you come at 7 o'clock, put the posters there, give the, I don't know, pins and waters, whatever it is to the participant for 1 hour, and then the rest of the day, you are free to do whatever you want to do. When everybody goes home at the 6 o'clock, you get the free dinner and also helping to change the posters. That's good. They may not put you in the downtown Hilton Hotel, $400 a night in San Francisco. They will put you in Oakland. It's a very nice facility over there, but they provide you with the tickets to get the train to come in the morning and then go home. And they have a special gathering for you also. They take you to places that normally they don't take the back. So there are always opportunities for the students to attend. They may not give you 100%, but they will give you some. Get that money. Then go to your advisor. Go to your dean to say that I manage for $1,500 travel, I already secured $600. How much you can? You also, as a graduate student, two things. Never miss a free deal. If it's in a church, you will go. If it's in a mosque, you will go. If it's in a temple, you will go. Free dinner is always good for the graduate student. Second, you need to have a team conference. So $600 you have, trip cost $1,500, then go and ask your team, ask your advisor. That they appreciate the effort, the initiative that you put. Instead of saying that, oh, there's no money. So I'm not going to go to the conference. Okay, let's see the question. Regardless of the method of developing a technical research proposal, whatever method you want to use, how minor cat is the craft,
and you can see the craft of the research by Ryan Wayne Booth et al., this book, and I think the library has this. This is it. Yeah, this is it. I think that the third edition is, so maybe there are some other editions of it. This is a wonderful book. It's very strong. And in my opinion, there should be a one-credit course for every student to make sure that everybody reads this book. It's telling you how to write a proposal. There are a lot of books, but I like this one. It's very important to systematically address these four: who, what, when, where, and why. So there's five. Okay, there's five. Who you are, what you're trying to do, how long will it take to do it, what are the facilities available to you, and why you want to do that one. What is the project? These are the. And this book has not only the online but also other approach. So if you are students in social science rather than physical science or engineering, you may want to approach it differently. Although I find answering this question always useful, no matter what is your major. You could pick up the example and try it. Makes sense. While current methodology, like an online question, does not guarantee success, not addressing these nine questions is sure to put your proposal in the risky path for success. And the risky is the risk of the death. Risk is not good. So you do whatever you have to do. I think that recap, answer every question of the application somewhere in your district. Make it easy for the reviewer to pick out the answer. I told you, my friends, some of them, they put the Italian. I don't do the Italian. I just write everything, but I'm saying that it is important to get assessments of the values of the big investments. This project will take 2 years of this, that amount of the money, whatever it is, and the rationale for that one is the following. So trying to answer those things somehow embedded there. Sometimes people write the question, which is good. I like it when they write the question and they write the answer. So I know that, okay, they read the outline. Every proposal for Department of Defense, you'll see that these questions either was explicitly written and the answer is there, or somehow implicitly the answers you could find. And the reviewer, you're reading five or six of these proposals, you're looking at that one, you have a highlighter in your hand, you say, okay, good, this one, good, not here, this is gold, next one. That's what you do. After you see that the answer to these questions was done, it may not be perfect, but the answer to the questions was there, then you go back and read. Make your answer as jargon-free as possible. Remember that one. The question for the expertise, those you can go jargons, but then you need to define your arguments. But majority of your proposal, you may have it. Even most of the proposal is a technical description. You can write as much equation as you like. Other parts of differential equation. I read parts of differential equation. How many air molecules went in your lung right now with one breath of fresh air? Just do it right together. Let's do it here, all of us. How many air molecules went in your lung?
Billions.
Let's look at the billions. 1 cubic centimeter, which is the size of a sugar cube, has 10 to the 19th air molecule. How do I know it? Chemistry, PVNRT. The P is the pressure, atmosphere, 10 to the 5 Pascal. V is 1 cubic centimeter. And then you have the N, number of the mole, R, gas constant, and T, temperature of this room, which is about 20, what is it? It's 300 degree Kelvin between friends. Okay, 27 degrees Celsius. So PVRRT You put in there, you find the number of mole multiplied by the Avogadro number. What is the Avogadro number? 6 × 10²³, you will say, if I give it a point. Then you will say that how many air molecules in 1 cubic centimeter, and the answer is 10^19, okay, 10^19. Human lung capacity is about 1 liter. 1 liter is 10³ cc. Some of us have bigger lungs, some of us have the smaller, some of us have bigger lungs, but because of years of smoking, now they have a little lung. But the average is about 1 liter. 1 liter is 10³. So, as you fill your lung, you take in 1,000 cc, which is 10³, multiply 10^19, and that will give you, what is the answer? 10³ multiply 10^19, it will give you 10^22. Remember that. There are 10^11 stars in our galaxy, Milky Way. 10^11. 10^11 is 100 billion stars in our galaxy. And there are 10^11 galaxies in the universe. So how many stars do we have in the universe, roughly, between friends? 10^11, multiplied by 10^11, that is 10^22. So in one breath of fresh air, you're taking as many stars in the universe, your own air molecule. Are you impressed?
Yes.
Now, if this was 1,000 years ago, and we were a group of a Pythagorean, you remember Pythagorean guys who said that's a science, you remember Pythagorean theory, right? These guys, they believed in numbers, they will swear on the numbers, they will keep it as a secret, the holy number for them 2,000 years ago was number 3, which later on went to the religion. Number 7 was a mysterious number. Number 19 was the justice number. Number 10 was the number of fertility for the mothers who were demanded to have a mortal child. They were wearing a medallion with an X on it, 10. Why 10 was fruit number? Because in the belly of the 10, it was a summation of the first 4 numbers. 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4. 4 plus 4 plus 11. 3 plus 4 plus 3 version of the Lord. This is way before Christianity. You read about it. These guys, they were the first vegetarian. But they hated beans. Because they believed beans was the cousin of humans. So when we eating beans, our body rejected. That's why we fought. So this is how they read about them. It's a wonderful. Did I say that? So 10^22. If this was many years ago, I could have convinced you like right now to sit down and pray with me, because I can find another 10^22 in the universe. This becomes a mystery now, like a 7, like a 4, like a 10, like a 19, which was the justice. So 10^22 will become a mystery. And now, what is that 10^22? You can calculate how many air molecules in the air atmosphere right now. Very simple calculation. You need all physics one and nothing more than that. And that's the 10^44 air molecule in hands. How many air molecules in one breath of fresh air? One breath of fresh air, we just calculated. 10^22. So 10^44 divided by 10^22 is 10^22. So air has 10^22 breath of air. Which means that if there were 10^22 people on the surface of this planet, fortunately it's not, right? It's like how many is 9 billion. But if it was 10^22 of us on the surface of the planet, and we all breathe at the same time, we suck up the atmosphere. So then 10^22. So if you look for it, you could find it. In the old days, people would find these things and then they go on their knee and they pray and say that there is just example. But I could find you 10^22 in the freons and molecules and so on and so forth. So, closing this has nothing to do with the horizon also, but just tell you that love what you do. explain things in the simple terms. You do not need sci-fi to enjoy science. There is enough enjoyment in the science that you do. And the language that you present in it is mathematics. Love mathematics, rest of us is coming. Good luck to you.
And then the last slide, I think I said something about this.
Good luck and happy writing.